Good morning. Oh, there we go. How are we today? We're doing okay? Gary, are you leading us today? Oh, you're sitting down. Okay. Please stand with us as we worship the Lord.
Echoes in my soul, I hear the music ring. And though the storms may come, I am holding on to the rock I cling. How can I keep from singing your praise? Step and I fall down again. I can sing 'cause you pick me up, sing 'cause you're there. I can sing 'cause you hear me, Lord, when I call to you in prayer. I can sing with my last breath, sing for I know, sing with the angels and the saints.
For coming today, and just Lord, just thank you so much for being kind and supportive. I know that Kristen and I have been tossing it back and forth as both of us have been out of town, and we just really appreciate your support.
Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day, Lord. We thank you for just the way you bless us, Lord, the way you provide for us, the way you hold us together, Lord. We just thank you and praise you for that. Lord, as we go into the service, we ask that you would just fill our hearts with joy. Lord, that our praise would bring honor and glory to you. Lord, that with Kevin, Lord, I pray that just the message you provide will be straight from your lips to us, Lord, not just from him. Lord, we want to hear from you today. Fill this place in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Release your worship. who've gone before us, and all who will believe, will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name.
Oh,
are not a God dependent on any mortal man. You are not a God in need of anything we can give by your plan. That's just the way it is.
You are God. God Almighty, who was and is to come.
dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we just thank you so much for the opportunity, Lord, just to praise you. And Lord, just thank you for that gift and that opportunity. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
So I have the pleasure of introducing to some of you, I think many of you know who this man is, but some of you do not. This is Kevin Parker and his wife, Susan. And Kevin was our pastor here many years ago, several years ago. And he's not only our former pastor, but Susan and Kevin and their family are tremendous dear friends to us. So thank you so much for coming.
Well, guys, it's good to be here with you this morning. If you love Jesus, say amen.
Amen.
If you love Jesus, say his name, Jesus. If you're excited about going to heaven, say praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Okay, now we've practiced. If you will do that while I preach, we'll get out sooner. Say amen.
Amen.
All right, you can help me. It's so good to be back. I know some of you I've never met before, and this morning it has been a pleasure to get to meet you, and I wish I had names and faces together with everyone. I just want you to know that you are precious to the Lord. God loves you very, very deeply. For those of you who I've known for a long, long time, gosh, it's good to see you. And it's just good to be here. I want to say a special word to you. If you're here this morning, whether you're young or whether you consider yourself older, I'm not going to use the word old, but if you're here this morning and you don't know for absolute sure that you're going to heaven when you die and that you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, today I want it to be your turning point. I just have a desire for you that you would hear God calling to you today, because God has a great plan for your life. And if you're a believer, I don't want you to forget that God still has a great and wonderful plan for your life. Okay, Baptist, let's do better than that. God has a great plan for your life.
Amen.
Amen. And you need to remember that. And no matter what happens, no matter what God is up to. Because I am now, I said earlier, for some of you, I still work for you. But for you who have never met me, I work for you because I'm one of your state missionaries. And it's exciting because now I get to go all over the state helping churches to lead people to Jesus, to build spiritual champions out of ordinary people, and to establish multiplying churches. Does that sound familiar? And I want you to, years ago, that became personal to me, and it has stayed with me. And so that's what I do now. My official title is Director of Media Services. That means I'm a techie. I love everything Daniel's got back there. It fascinates me. And at one point, God called me to preach and stand on this side of it. And guys, I love to preach. I love churches. I love people. I'm an introvert, and what that means is I eventually get done with people. And I need to leave the planet, so I'm a Trekkie. And God has given me an outlet to leave the planet. And so that's me. That's me. I'm not the best Christian in the world. I don't do everything right. I've made my share of mistakes.
Amen.
Yeah, yeah. You didn't all have to say that. But that's who I am. And I'm so thankful to God because he's been gracious to me. And as you participate in the bigger work across our convention, I want you to know something's actually happening because of that. It's not just that somebody is tending to churches who don't have pastors, or that we're helping churches who are struggling financially or whatever. I want you to know people are getting saved. So during the month of February, March isn't over, or I'd tell you about March, but during the month of February, just one of our campuses, our Christian Challenge campuses, okay, you were helping through the staff there to train students to go out and to share the gospel with other students on campus. Okay, I don't know what gets you going, but I want to tell you what needs to get you going this morning is somebody telling somebody about Jesus. And so you get to do that. You're always doing that. Every week you're doing that, especially during the school year. You're making a difference. And during February, on one of our campuses, just one of them, teams of two were going out, students on campus, looking for people to share the gospel with. And during that month, they were able to have 40 gospel conversations with different people. Isn't that awesome? And five people in those gospel conversations, five of those students whom they talked to, they shared the gospel with them, and not only that, but they invited them to trust Jesus as their Savior. And five times right out there on campus, wherever they met them, students trusted in Christ as their Savior and had their life changed for all eternity. And you did that. You're part of that. Now, I want to make it more personal to you. Those are just numbers, and numbers are nice. But listen to this. This was just 10 days ago. This is Chloe and Gabe. Gabe and I shared on campus, and we met Felicity. Felicity is a high schooler getting her associate's degree through an early college program in Las Cruces. Upon asking her about her thoughts on spiritual things, you taught them to do that. You taught them to ask that question. She mentioned that she'd grown up Catholic, but she fell away due to a lot of church hurt and feeling forced by her family to adopt a religion. Say, oh me. You know what I'm talking about. We know her story. However, Felicity expressed a deep interest in God and was definitely searching for a way to be close to Him. A college student that you are raising to be a spiritual champion wrote words like that. She wasn't sure what made her right with God, but tried to live a good life and serve others. As I went through the presentation, I explained to her the concept of sin and how Jesus is the solution for all brokenness and that He is the only way to God and to living a life of goodness. You taught college students to say those things, to know those things, to share and explain those things. Amen? That's what it means to cooperate together. Felicity expressed, listen to this, that she had never heard Jesus explained to her this way and believed that He truly is the only solution that she's been looking for. And after our conversation, we prayed, and Felicity made the decision to give her life to Jesus today. Amen? That happened because you participate with other churches and having these ministries and many other ministries that help the gospel to go where lost people are. You already live around lost people all the time. Amen? But there are lost people you don't live around, and because we cooperate together, Felicity is our sister in Christ today. So as we begin, would you join me? Let's pray for Felicity in her new walk with God. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank You for the chance to be part of this story that I've just read. And we right now want to pray for our new sister, Felicity. And we just ask, God, that You'd help her as she plugs into a church family, that she would understand the words that she hears. Lord God, put people around her who will patiently explain things that she's never heard before. Father, I just pray that You'd put people around her and put her in a place where she can grow up to be a spiritual champion. Heavenly Father, I pray and I ask that in the sweet and holy name of Jesus. Say that name with me, Jesus. Amen. You'll understand that I enjoy participative preaching. Yeah, there you go. This morning I want to talk to you about God's glory and your gospel activity. I want to encourage you this morning, actually. You know, I could go through a passage, and I had intended to do this, a passage where I showed you once again how it's our responsibility to share the gospel. How many of you already know from the Scripture that it's our responsibility to share the gospel? Raise your hand up high. Let's see. Okay, I think most of us are already there. And so I thought, you know, what I'd really like to do is I'd like to encourage you, because most Christians will say they know that. But there's a smaller percentage that will actually do things to share their faith, to share the gospel, to invite other people to trust Jesus as your Savior. None of us would be here today if somebody had not invited us to trust Jesus as our Savior. For me, that was Vincent Cervera, and he is now in heaven. I want to encourage you to know how God makes you able to do all that. Because over and over and over, I hear that either I'm not able or I don't really understand everything, or I don't know how to do that. I'm not going to teach you a gospel presentation this morning. I'm going to teach you God's Word. And so this morning, here's my takeaway. This is what I want you to leave with. This is my big idea, that God set gospel activity in motion when He saved me. And I don't want you just to think about me. I want you to place your yourself in that me position. God set gospel activity in motion when he saved me. And so I ask you, if you would turn to 2 Corinthians in chapter 3 and verse 4, you can navigate there, or you can turn in your Bibles there. However you do it, just get there while I tell you a story. Some of you have already heard this story. I love this story. I can't tell it enough. There's a friend of mine who's in heaven today. His name is Mike Hedler. And I got to be part of Mike Hedler's salvation story. I'm so glad God let me be a part of that story. But Mike Hedler is one of those guys that once he got saved, he was so saved. I don't know, do you know what I mean? He was so saved. You just could see him, and you know, that guy is saved. Even if you didn't know what it meant, you probably would say, that guy's saved. He was just one of those kind of guys. When Mike Hedler trusted in Jesus Christ at 5:30 a.m. on a Sunday morning, sitting in front of a television screen, watching a preacher preach and listening to a gospel presentation, God flipped a switch in Mike Hedler, and he not only got saved, he got changed. Let me explain to you what I mean by Mike Hedler got changed. Okay, I'm going to get out of breath telling this story because I got out of breath experiencing this story. I walked into the worship center when I was an associate minister of media at First Baptist Church of West Palm Beach years and years ago. I walked into the worship center, and there was Mike. Over time, Mike became our electrician and painter. It was a large church, and we had an electrician and painter on staff. And that was him. And I walked in, and Mike is sitting there with a pallet, a tall pallet full of light bulbs. We had cove lighting. It was indirect lighting. It went all the way around the room. It was a big worship center, and it was about 30, 35 feet up to the cove where the lights were. It was all light bulbs, not fluorescents. It was built before then, you know what I mean? And they were all light bulbs. And I walked in, and I saw this, and I thought, poor Mike. But not Mike. Remember, Mike is saved. And so I look at this and I think, I'm just going to ask. So Mike, what are you doing? Oh my gosh, it was like I flipped on a switch. He picked up a light bulb and he said, do you see this? Do you know what this is? And I thought, well, I'm just going to try it. It's a light bulb, Mike. He said, that's right. And do you know what happens to this light bulb? When I take it up this ladder, bless his heart, he had a 35-foot extension ladder, and he had it stretched up to that cove, and he was going to have to go up there and down for every light bulb several hundred times all around the room. I was just trying to encourage the guy, you know what I mean? He said, do you know what's going to happen to this light bulb when I climb up that ladder and I get to the top and I screw it into the socket? Guys, I'm stumped on this one. I said, Mike, tell me what's going to happen to it. He said, when I screw it into the socket, it'll be just like me. When I trusted Jesus as my Savior, I got screwed into the socket. So whenever God wanted to turn on the power, I'd light up and everybody would see light. He said, isn't that great? He said, so what's going to happen to me today is I'm going to get to go up and down this ladder and I'm going to get to take all these light bulbs and I'm going to get to screw them into the socket where they can access the power. And I'm going to get to think about over and over and over how God saved me. Because it tires me to tell that story. And that's Mike. And that's just one story. Ask me later about some other stories. When God saved Mike Hedler, God set gospel activity in motion. I can't tell you how many people were touched by Mike's life and heard the gospel through Mike and were invited to follow Christ through Mike and had their life changed for eternity just like his life was changed. God flipped a switch in Mike, and it changed Mike, and it changed other people because of Mike. And I believe from this passage that we're just about to look at, listen to me and listen to me closely. I believe when you got saved, when God forgave you of your sins, when he gave you eternal life and changed your eternal destiny, that he flipped a switch in you. And the devil doesn't like what happens when that switch is flipped. And so ever since then, he's been telling lies. He's been telling people lies. And too many people have begun to believe the lies and not the truth. And so I want you to see this passage. In this passage, what we've got to do to understand this is we've got to connect. We've got to figure out what it is, and we've got to connect God's glory and you. Golly, we sang that song a few minutes ago about seeing. Oh, where's Sharda? Where are you? There you are. Seeing something about, like, you see Jesus' glory or something like that. And guys, I was ready to preach then. I'm so sorry we had to have a couple more songs. I was ready to go. Because God's glory is something absolutely amazing. And Revelation song, can I have a moment of nostalgia? Can I just have a moment? Lois Duter sat right over here. And she loved that song, and she's in heaven today. And she knows it's all true. Guys, what I'm talking about today is all true. And saints who've gone ahead of us will tell us that it's all true. And that's our job. Our job is to get people home safe. And there's lots of people out there who are not safe. And God set gospel activity in motion when He saved you. And He did everything to make it possible and to make it work. And the devil's just been lying to us over and over and over. Listen to what this passage says. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 4. Now that you're all settled, would you stand with me in honor of the reading of God's Word? 2 Corinthians 3, verse 4. You'll find words similar to this, thank you, in your translation of Scripture. Such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. Not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything is coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God, who has made us sufficient to be ministers of a new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. Now the ministry of death, if the ministry of death, carved in letters on stone, came with such glory that the Israelites could not gaze at Moses' face because of its glory, which was being brought to an end, will not the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? For if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed it in glory. Indeed, in this case, what once had glory has come to have no glory at all because of the glory that surpasses it. For if what was being brought to an end came with glory, much more will what is permanent have glory. Since we have such a hope, we are very bold, not like Moses, who put a veil over his face so that the Israelites might not gaze at the outcome of what was being brought to an end. But their minds were hardened, for to this day, when they read the Old Covenant, that same veil remains unlifted, because only through Christ is it taken away. Say amen. Amen. Yet to this day, whenever Moses is read, a veil lies over their hearts. But when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Say amen. Amen. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. Your translation may say from glory to glory. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. Would you pray with me? Gracious Heavenly Father, I pray and ask of you that you would help us to hear your voice this morning through this passage. Father, I pray that you'd eclipse me. It eclipses the concerns of our hearts and draw us so to you that you become the focus of our thoughts and our heart. Lord God, make this word come living and active in our souls. We pray it in the sweet and holy name. Say that name with me, Jesus. We pray it in that name, O Lord. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Now I want you to notice this passage starts out saying, such is the confidence that we have through Christ toward God. And in verse 12 it says, since we have such a hope, we're very bold. What's happening here in this context is Paul is talking about his ministry. He's specifically talking about his gospel activity in his ministry and how it happened. He's trying to help them realize, the people in Corinth, that what's happening with him came from God, that God did this, that this is a ministry from God, this is an activity from God. It's absolutely amazing. And we look at Paul, and many times we think, yeah, that's what God did in Paul. But the principles here are true principles for all of us as saints. God does this in each one of us. And so I want you to realize that when he said he had confidence, it was not because of anything he knew or had been trained in or any of that. It was because of God. And when he said he was very bold, it was because of the hope that he had through Jesus Christ, not because of his education, not because of the slickness of his presentation, not because of any of that, because he knew Jesus and Jesus had flipped his switch. Do you believe this morning that God could flip your switch? Do you believe this morning that God could flip your switch? Do you believe this morning that God could flip your switch? Yes, God can. He can do amazing through us. I want you to see what he can do. Here's where I want to travel today. This is my journey. I want us to see how God enables us for gospel activity by making us sufficient. Then I want you to see how God unveils us so that we can understand his truth. And then I want you to see how God changes us for gospel activity. Are you ready to go? Okay, first let's start out here. God makes me sufficient for glory-filled ministry. And this text starts out in verse 4. It says such. Such is a pointing word, such as. It points to something. It can either point to what came before or it can point to what comes afterwards. And in this case, it's pointing to what follows the words. Such is the confidence we have through God, toward God, not that we are sufficient in ourselves to claim anything is coming from us, but our sufficiency is from God. That's what the scripture says. This word sufficient is very, very important. Here's what it means. If I go apply for a job, I have to be qualified for that job. By the way, I've got an opening on my team. If you want to be a writer, please see me after the service. But when you apply for a job, you have to be qualified. And so somebody's going to sit down and look through your experiences and all that and see if you're qualified. And to be engaged in gospel activity is no different. You have to be qualified. And what this word means is that God comes and he qualifies you. He makes you fit for the task. He checks off all the boxes for you. He comes and does a work in your life that makes you absolutely 100% totally qualified for gospel activity. Say amen. That's what God does. Now, there are people who are working so hard to try and figure out how they could do this. They want to learn another presentation. And they want to learn another way to start off a gospel conversation with somebody. They want to learn all of these things. And so many people, how many of you know more than one gospel presentation? Raise your hand. Raise it up high. We know a lot of gospel presentations. But the question is, yes, do we use them? And then do we follow that use by inviting somebody to follow Jesus? And see, what the Bible actually says is that when God comes and he saves us, that what he does is he fully qualifies us. We are totally fit for the task. We are qualified for the job. So here this morning, I want to encourage you, and you may be thinking, oh, please don't say that, please don't say that, but I'm going to tell you anyway. I want you to know you are qualified for the task that God has given the church. Every one of you, if you know Jesus, you are 100% qualified. You are fit for the task. You meet all the qualifications. You're ready to go. And I think that's really exciting. You know, qualifications we normally think of as knowledge and skill and ability and personality and desire and passion. I want you to know when I hire somebody, I'm looking for all of those kind of things. But the greatest thing that we have when it comes to gospel activity is that Jesus is our Savior and that he came and he flipped our switch. Is that he came and he flipped our switch. Pause for effect. And so we need God to do what only God can do. That's what we need. We need God to come in and do only what God can do. And so I want to ask you again, do you believe that God can flip your switch? God flipped Mike Hetzler's switch, and it was amazing. I want you to see, he doesn't just qualify us. We'll go on in verses 7 through 11. He tells us how much he qualifies us. Because I think just knowing that you're qualified, it doesn't necessarily get the juices flowing. And I think Paul knew that, so he explained how. And he does it by this passage of Scripture that describes two different ministries or covenants and two different glories. Okay, so stay with me here. The glory of God would be his shine, or his radiance, or his glow, or the light, or his appearance, if you will. And it comes from his beauty and his majesty, his wonder, his awe, his amazingness. And he just glows. He just glows. And back in their day, they were familiar. They were familiar with this concept. I don't know that we're so familiar today. So I want to walk with you through a couple examples. In Luke chapter 17 and verse 2, I'll start at the first verse. Just listen to it. Write down the reference. You can look at it later. Luke 17, 2. It says this, "And after 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves," just them, "and he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun." How could they even see anything else? Do you realize what that says? "His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light." That's amazing. They experienced that, and they told stories about that. And then over in, that was Matthew 17 too. I'm sorry, I might have said Luke. Over in Luke chapter 2 and verse 9. In Luke chapter 2 and verse 9, I'll start a verse ahead again. This is from the Christmas story, by the way. "And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field keeping over their watch by daylight." By night. Night. Dark, guys. Dark. By night. "And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were filled with great fear." What just happened to Jesus' face on the Mount of Transfiguration? It glowed like a light bulb. No, it glowed like the sun. It shone like the sun. And they're out there, and heaven becomes alive before these shepherds, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. Yeah, night was turned into day. That would shake you up if you were a shepherd way out there in the middle of nowhere with a bunch of sheep that you're supposed to protect. Yes. And so they were familiar with this. In Revelation, and John wrote about home. This is from my postcard from home. I love it. Revelation 21, verse 23. I'll start again a verse early. "And I saw no temple in the city." This is the New Jerusalem. "I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of the sun or moon to shine upon it." Are you remembering why? "For the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb." If you jump down to verse 5 of chapter 22, it says and about that city, "And night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever." When we were singing like we could see the glory or whatever it was that we were saying, I'm thinking, yes, yes, sing that way. Guys, this church is known for worshiping the Lord God. And so you should sing that way, because home is real and we're going home, amen? I don't know when, but it's soon. It's soon. I've read the description. It's soon. And so they were familiar with all of this. So there's these two covenants, and each one has its own glory. And this is the kind of glory we're talking about. And there's the old covenant, which would be the Old Testament law and all that. There's the new covenant, and that's the covenant through Jesus Christ by faith. The one's called the covenant of the Spirit. The other one's called the covenant of the letter. The covenant of the Spirit, or the ministry of the Spirit, it's new, it says. It brings life and righteousness, and its effects is permanent. You hear that? Permanent. But the ministry of the letter, it said it kills. It brought death and condemnation, and it was fading and ending. But it had glory nonetheless. And whose glory did it have? It had God's glory. It has God's glory. And so here's what the Scripture is going to say. If over here is the ministry of the letter, and over here is the ministry of the Spirit, I want you to think of a spectrum of difference between that glory and this glory. Okay? The old glory and the new glory, the fading glory and the permanent glory. Here's what it says. Look at these words here. You can look at them in your Scripture. In verse 8, It says this, will not the ministry of the Spirit have even more glory? That's actually in the language of the New Testament, more glory. And so if there's this amount of glory over here on the old covenant, then there's some amount more of glory. I don't know, you can think about how much more of shining like the sun you think is more glory. But it says more glory, but it goes on and it describes it even further. It's not just more. So maybe you get from there to here. But it says something else. It says this. In verse 9 it says, for if there was glory in the ministry of condemnation, the ministry of righteousness must far exceed it in glory. So if I leave glory, the old utter glory, and I come over here and now I'm in more glory, all right? Are you with me? And then I look out there like this. And I look for far exceeding glory. I'm going to look over here and I'm going to see this glory. Guys, there's a tremendous difference between the glory of the old covenant and the glory of the new. And here's why he's telling this. If you want to know how qualified you are, before you were saved, you were not qualified for gospel activity. But after you're saved, you're more qualified. You're not only more qualified, you're far exceeding what you used to be. As a matter of fact, your qualification is the difference between the old glory and the new glory. What God did to qualify you for gospel activity matches the incredible glory of the Almighty God. That's how qualified you are. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that exciting? Because, I know I don't have it in and of my own. And to know that that's behind me, and that's exciting. And so our sufficiency matches the level of His glory. That is just amazing. And so we have made sufficient, and we put it together with more glorious or far exceeding glory. And then in verse 12, you get the effect of that. Since we have such a hope, isn't that a great hope? Isn't that a great hope? Since we have such a great hope, we are very bold. It actually says in the original language, much bold. We're very bold. Very bold. And so glory, the description of it, fuels gospel ministry by showing us just how incredibly and thoroughly God has enabled us for gospel activity. That's you. And when we're talking about that God started to put gospel activity in motion when I got saved, when you got saved, This is what he did. Mike Hedler, let me tell you what, Mike Hedler was no theologian. The stories I could tell, the discoveries he made, it was just amazing. But from day one, he was fully qualified just like this. 100% fully qualified before he ever took an evangelism presentation class. How is that possible? Well, think about this. So Moses, when he went to talk to God, and the glory of God shone on him, and he left the tent of meeting, and he shined with the glory of God, right? Okay, so he had to go meet with a God that was outside of him. And when he left that conversation, he left the God who was outside of him, and he walked away. And the glory that he had was residual glory. And that's not what we're dealing with today, because when you get saved, the Spirit of Jesus Christ, it doesn't stay over there in the tent of meeting. Where does it come? It comes within us. Within us. And so when we shine with God's glory, it's not a residual glory of something that's passing away. It's direct glory of the Jesus who actually lives within us. And listen, if Jesus wants you to tell somebody about Him, He can do it through you because He knows His story. He's got it. That's how He qualifies you. He gets inside of you. It's absolutely amazing. And so God makes us sufficient for a glory-filled ministry. But I want you to see this, that God removes my veil so I can understand His truth. Guys, I used AI for this. I just thought I'd try this. I've never done this before. I'll probably never do it again. And nothing I'm going to teach you is going to have to do with AI. But I want you to see the pictures. You see, a veil is something that hides something else so that you can't really see it. All right? That's what a veil does. It hides something. And Paul, in the next few verses, when he starts in verse 13, he begins to walk through something he knows about from the past, something he sees in the present and a possibility that he knows could be. So something he knows about from the past, something he sees in the present, and a possibility that he knows it could be. And I want you to see how those go. So let's look at the first picture. This is a great picture. Look how many collars this man has. AI, that's why they call it artificial intelligence. I asked for a picture of a man, a line drawing of a man who was looking to the side like that. And I put in there, this is just because of me, guys, with hair. I put that in. I took it out and got this guy, because if you tell an AI to draw somebody with hair, guys, it's just way, way too much hair. Way too much hair. And so I took it out and I got this guy. And this over here, this represents the glory that's on Moses. He has gone to visit with the Lord God Almighty, and the glory of God is shining, and people can't even look at him because of the glory of God. So what you've got is think of this for a moment about the past that Paul knew. Over here, we've got the Israelites in the wilderness. And Moses put a veil over his face so that they couldn't see God's glory on him. And it was fading away. And that's what Paul remembers. That's where all this next little piece of passage is going to come from. He takes this picture and he begins to take it and use it figuratively, if it will. So go to the next one. This is the present that Paul sees around him. And so now this guy over on this side with all the collars, okay? These are the Jews in Paul's day. Paul looks at the Jews in his day around him, and he says a veil obscures their heart. And so when they read the Old Testament law, they can't see the truth, because from the very beginning, God has been telling them that Messiah is coming, that salvation is coming. But they would look and they would read the old Mosaic covenant. They would read the law. They'd unroll the scrolls and they read that. But they couldn't see God's truth. And there was a veil that cloaked that. And then Paul sees a possibility. And guys, this is exciting, because Paul sees a possibility where somebody trust the Lord, and God removes that veil, and suddenly they're able to look at the law, and they're actually able to comprehend and see and understand God's truth, because the veil has been lifted. Do you see where this is going? And so this is what happens. And so they can see the truth in God's word that was previously hidden. Mike knew what a Bible was, but one day he met Jesus. And there was a day I'm sitting at my desk working on something in my nice office, and I've got stuff sprawled out all over my desk, and Mike walks in, and he didn't go, "Excuse me, can I come in?" No, this is Mike, because the switch is on, and he just comes in, and he's carrying a big Bible, because when you're really saved like Mike, you carry a big Bible everywhere you go. And so Mike came in with his big Bible, and he walked over behind my desk right beside me and takes his big Bible, and he plops it right down where I'm working, and he said, "You're not going to believe this." He said, "I just found this morning. Kevin, this is so amazing." And he began to read these words to me: "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have eternal life." Mike had just learned that. You see, he knew about the Bible before, but once he got saved and the switch got flipped, and God removed his veil, and he was able to see God's truth, and he was able to see that and understand what God was saying. And I want you to know, he came into my office pumped up. Isn't that amazing? That was Mike. It was just who he was. And so this is what Paul is talking about, and what we need to understand. Go on to that next slide, because I want you to see this statement. God removes my veil. When I get saved, God removes my veil so I can understand his truth. Listen, you don't have to go to seminary to be able to understand the Bible. Because I know Jesus, and I've been to seminary. And I want you to know, if you know Jesus, God can use the scripture to speak truth to you. And that's what happens. So not only does God completely qualify you, but he unveils you so you can understand the truth. And so you can't say, oh, I'm not qualified to do this. I can't do this. I don't have those skills. You can't say that. And you can't actually say, you know, I really don't understand all that. It doesn't make sense to me. You see, those things would be the lies the devil has been telling all along, because what God does is he qualifies you and he unveils you. Isn't that great? I mean, that really makes you, if only you were good looking too, amen? I mean, wouldn't that help? Wouldn't that really help? Well, God's got you covered, because the last piece of this passage is God places some of his glory on you. And I want you to know there's nothing more beautiful, more attractive, more amazing than God's glory. And that's what God does, is he takes some of his glory and he puts it on you. In verses 17 it says, and 18, it says, Now the Lord is the Spirit. And he says that to verify that this is all God's ministry. Because remember, the ministry that he was part of was the ministry of the Spirit, not of the letter. And now he says the Lord is the Spirit. This is God's ministry. He had started out saying, I'm only sufficient because of what God's doing. And he's trying to put that in perspective here. Now the Lord is the Spirit. It's very Trinitarian too. Say amen. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. And that kind of freedom we need. The kind of freedom to be free from the devil and him saying, no, don't do that. No, don't do that. They probably won't listen to you. They'll probably be rude to you. And God just wants you to talk to somebody, whatever it is. And so there's freedom for you to do what God wants you to do. Verse 18, I love this. And we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord. Are you ready for it? Are being transformed into the same image. Now listen to that. Listen to that. Now we all with unveiled face, that's all those who believe in Jesus, are beholding and beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image. I don't mean that God is making you little gods. That's another religion. Please don't go down the street to their church. It's not true. But God is making us like him in character and in his nature. We'll even one day live for all eternity. God is doing that. And right now, he's transforming us. He's changing us. But guys, as great as that is, I think what comes next is the most amazing. Being transformed into the same image from glory to glory. Now, if I hadn't explained to you a few minutes ago the two glories, you might not get what he's talking about. He's talking about from the old glory to the new glory. You want to know how much he's changing you and how much he's trying to put his glory upon you? It's the same as the difference between that old glory and that new glory. That's how he's transforming us from glory to glory. He's changing us. When we talk about the church being a lighthouse, you just can think about it. Think about it. A whole church full of people. You remember when people used to squeeze into Volkswagen bugs? A whole church full of people has Jesus inside. God's transforming them from glory to glory, so they're slowly glowing brighter and brighter and brighter. And we take that whole church and we squeeze them all in together and put them at the top of a lighthouse. Guys, that'll give light to everybody, just like Mike's light bulb. And that's what God is trying to do. And the devil's been deceiving us. No, we're not sufficient for that. We can't ever be that. He can even make you good looking. He puts his glory on you. And guys, I read this and I fall under conviction myself. And the Word of God, I read the Word of God and I experience his glory. That's how we do it these days. And then he transforms me and he transforms you. You should be changing. Will you let God change you? Will you let God flip your switch? A transformation changes us into his image and into glory. And so you think about that. God comes and he does that. So I don't want to hammer you about what God has given the church to do. I want to encourage you and let you know what God comes to you to do through you. How he comes and he does something with you that you could never do. That he comes and flips a switch that you can't flip. that he does that. And he does that because he loves you and because he loves other people. It says twice in here. It says in verse 15, this is how I know this applies to everybody, not just to Paul. Yet to this day, whenever Moses had read, a veil lies over their hearts. Verse 16, but when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. When they turn to the Lord, when they trust Jesus. And then it says in verse 8, it says that just before that, I think I got myself out of place, and I hate it when that happens. When they read the Old Covenant, that same veil remains, this is verse 14, because only through Christ is it taken away. And then in verse 16, when one turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. Guys, that's when it happens. That's when all of this happens. It's at salvation. You don't need to somehow develop some discipline for this to happen to you. Because where the Spirit is, there is freedom. And if you'll just let God be in you what He wants to be, He can save people from their sins by using you to share His story so they'll come to Him and receive what only He can do. And so I think about those things and I think they're fire starters. Guys, I watch Mike Hedler, they're fire starters in him. I look at him as I go over and over them, as I think about them, as I experience them. They're having an effect on me. They're fire starters. And I believe with all my heart that they can start a fire in you. That God wants to start a fire in you. God has enabled me for gospel activity. I am very sufficient. You need to think these things about yourself. God has unveiled me for gospel activity. I can see and understand the truth. And God has changed me for gospel activity. I'm being made to look more and more like Him. Praise Jesus. Praise Jesus. And so the takeaway is simply this. Now maybe it'll make more sense. God set gospel activity in motion when He saved me. Do you believe that? Do you believe that? Mike Hedler turned to Jesus and I saw all of these things in Him. I saw it before my eyes. It was amazing. But here's the question that I have to grapple with. When I am reading the Scripture, it's not about Mike Hedler for me. It's me. And the same for you. It's for you. It's not for me. It's for you when you read the Scripture. And so I have to ask this question. Yes, I saw those things in Mike Hedler, but can others see those things in me? Or am I listening more to the lies of the devil than the truth of God? I believe in this passage, we're given two things. We're given a starting point and a return point. Because the language in the Scriptures is when they turn to the Lord. Perhaps this morning you're here and you're hearing me talk about all this and you're thinking, I don't know that I've had that experience with Jesus. I don't really know that I've got heaven nailed down. This sounds a little foreign to me. Well, maybe this morning you need to, for the first time ever, you need to turn to the Lord. Maybe you need to turn to Jesus and receive forgiveness of sins and eternal life and the presence of God in your life by God's Spirit. And this work, this comes with salvation. Maybe you need to be saved today. That's what I'm saying. Maybe you need to trust Jesus as your Savior. So maybe you need to turn. Or there's that revival point this morning. Believers, listen to me. Look up here. Listen to me. This is what God does when He saves people. Do you need to return? Do you need to return to the Lord this morning? Do you need to come back to that place of freedom? Do you need to return to Him? So I ask you right now just to bow your heads and close your eyes. Bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm just going to ask that nobody be peeking and looking around. But me, if you hear footsteps, Sharda's coming up here on the platform. She can peek so she can walk. But don't look around. This is between people and the Lord. I want to ask you this morning, if you're thinking, I'm not sure I know Jesus as my personal Savior, and you're in this room and you're hearing my voice, here's the first thing I want you to do. If you're thinking that's you, whether you want to make a decision to follow Him or not, This morning, I'm going to ask you, would you just raise your hand up high in the air right now and just say, I'm not sure I have salvation like you're talking about. Raise your hand up high in the air. I see your hand. I see your hand. Anybody else here? I see your hand. I see your hand. Anyone else? Raise your hand up high. I'm not sure. I see your hand. Okay, you can put your hands down. Now this morning, if you're here and you're feeling God just speaking to your heart, not Kevin speaking to your heart, but God speaking to your heart through His Word, because that's what's important. The preacher doesn't matter. The Scripture does. And if you feel like God is calling you to return to Him into this freedom of gospel activity, would you just, whether you're ready to say, yeah, I'm going to do that or not, but if you feel like He's calling you, would you just raise your hand up high in the air? Raise your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. I see your hand. Anybody else? I feel like God is calling me to return to Him today. Okay, we've had hands raised both times. I want to pray for you who've raised your hands this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, there are individuals among us who are not absolutely sure about their salvation. And this morning, I ask of you that you would encourage their hearts so that they would seek you and come and say, I want to follow Jesus. We ask that you would do that work in their hearts so they can have the salvation that we have as saints in this room. We want to share that with them. And so, God, I ask you to draw them to that place. And, Father, I pray for those who raise their hands wanting to return to you. Father, I pray that you would put every opportunity before them for them to understand your truth and for them to see your power at work and help them to understand how that power resides within them by your Spirit. And encourage them and give them opportunities to be engaged in gospel activity, however it may be, whether it's direct or indirect. Lord, draw them into the center of what God is doing. And Heavenly Father, I want to pray for everybody who didn't raise their hand. Father, I want to thank you for the saints who didn't raise their hand, who are seeking you and living in this freedom and sharing the gospel and doing it by your sufficiency. I thank you for them and the work that you've done in their life. And Father, I thank you for every saint in this room that you've come to do this work in. I just pray, Father, we'd all be able to see it in one another. I ask that. And Father, I pray for those individuals who either want to turn to Jesus or return to you, who didn't raise their hands. I pray, Father, that you'd stir up within them by the conviction of your Spirit, stir up within them a boldness to step out and follow you. Heavenly Father, we stand before you as saints. Not a perfect one in this room. But Lord God, we've come to hear a word from the perfect God. Father, change us. Help us not to leave here and leave your word in this place. Knit it into our hearts and make it part of us. We pray it in the sweet and holy name. Say that name, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Sharda is going to sing. We're going to have a song of invitation. The invitation is simply this. It's simply this. If you don't know your Jesus as your Savior, would you come up here to me and just say, I want to follow Jesus? You don't need to be a theologian or know all the answers. I don't, and none of us here do. But you do need salvation. Come say, I need to follow Jesus. If that's you this morning, don't wait. Don't look to see anybody else move. You make the first move. I'll be standing down here waiting on you. Now, this morning, if you feel like you need to return to the Lord God, need somebody to pray for you, you can come down and say, would you just pray for me? You were talking about returning, and I need to turn to God again in this way. And I'll pray over you. If you have some need upon your heart, some burden that you just need somebody to pray for you, you don't have to come and tell the whole story. God already knows the story, but it would be my pleasure and my honor to stand before Him and cry out for you. I'd love to pray for you. And you can just come and request prayer. If you've trusted Jesus as your Savior and you've never been baptized, it's time. It's time. Today is the day for you to say, yes, I'm going to obey Jesus in that. Come and say, I need to be baptized. If you're here and you don't have a church home, well, you don't need to look any further. And all God's people said amen. You just need to come down and say, I want to be part of this church. What does that even mean? And we'll help you. Whatever God has set on your heart this morning, you say yes to Him. Don't miss this chance. God is speaking. God is here. God is amazing. Would you pray with me one more time before we start? Gracious Heavenly Father, we just come before You and ask You to work among us. Thank You for this word. Thank You for our friendships. Thank You for Your presence in this place. Well, Father, help us now as we pray about and make decisions about what You want us to do. Father, help us. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. You come.
Jesus, our glory and our
we turn our eyes to you.
Please be seated for announcements.
Good morning, friends. Thank you for making worship a priority in your life. I hope you've enjoyed your worship experience with us this morning. I'm Josiah, and it is my pleasure to share with you a few things that I think you might want to take part in. The March Baptism Celebration is this afternoon at 4:30 p.m. Immediately following the baptisms, we will have a party in the Fellowship Hall. Cake and other goodies will be served. Be present to encourage those that are following Christ in baptism. Doug Hatfield will be starting a 5-week discipleship group this evening at 5:30 p.m. on The Case for Miracles by Lee Strobel. Sign up on the sign-up board if you wish to attend the class. We will be showing Sunrise in Heaven this evening at 5:30 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall for family movie night. Bring snacks to share and comfy chairs if you wish. Invite your friends and family. If you are 55 or over, there is a luncheon for you on Thursday, March 21st at 11:30 a.m. The luncheon will be served in the Fellowship Hall, followed by a brief ministry opportunity that provides encouragement and the love of God to the recipient. Come join us. Do you love working with infants and toddlers? Then we need your help in the nursery. We are looking for a nursery director and helpers for Sunday mornings and evenings and Wednesday evenings. See Crystal in the office for a job application during normal office hours. We're so glad you decided to spend your Sunday morning with us. We believe First Baptist Aztec is a place for you to find hope, healing, and a church to call home. If this is your first time here, please fill out the guest information card found in the back of your chair and in front of you. Bring it with you to meet Pastor Austin outside the north doorway, where you will receive your favorite soda, candy bar, and a gift. Thanks again for worshiping the Lord with us today. And guests, welcome home.
I mean, through Bible study and friends, it's just amazing. Look around. Look around, and heaven's going to be 10 times better. Are you excited about that? Guys, thank you for coming. Thank you for one another, to coming and being here, the encouragement you are to one another. Would you stand with me? I want to pray us out of here. And if you're a guest, I do want to encourage you to head over here for the calorie-free soda and chocolate bar from Pastor Austin. Right, wave your hand over there. Right over there. Don't miss it. Don't miss it. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, you are so good. You are so good in this place. And you are so good to us. Father, I just pray your blessings on First Baptist Church of Aztec. Father, I just pray as you prepare the next man of God that you want to draw to come here and to be pastor. We pray for that man and his family right now, that you just bless him right where he is and prepare him for this place. And Father, I pray for this church family, that you would prepare him and prepare them for that man, for him. That you do whatever work you need to do here, so that when he comes, we'll see the match of God. And Father, we just ask you to do this work among us. And Father, as we walk through these doors into the mission field, Father, help your heart to be on our heart. Lord God, encourage those who are weak. And Father, we pray for those who are not here today because of illness and other things. We ask you to care for them. And Father, give them the strength and energy they need for recovery. Father, we just pray and we seek these things of you in the sweet and holy name of Jesus. Say that name with me, Jesus. It's in that name we pray together. Amen. God bless you.